We all know the advantages, better resolution of superficial structures, and that's where there is a drawback. That depth, you can't really, you know, you can't have a good penetration, but the resolution is always better. Nowadays, it is not just linear transducers. In fact, we have a lot of companies coming up with convex transducers, which are, you know, high frequency. There are transducers with 2 to 9 convex also available, but by and large, we still are using the linear transducers, 5 to 12 megahertz or 4 to 9 megahertz to get these the abdominal structures seen better. So in the intra-abdominal, of course, we know bowel pathologies like appendicitis, most common, Cox, colitis, omental and mesenteric pathologies. It may be just a thickening, there may be lymph nodes, there may be infarction. Then, of course, we can really depict pneumoperitoneum very well on ultrasound, ascites, if it is exudative, transudative, collections which are, you know, localized, especially at some particular point, will be seen better on the linear high-frequency probes. So typical gut signature bowel, we all know there are 5 layers. The superficial mucosa interface is echogenic, then there is muscularis mucosa, which is hypoechoic, then there is submucosa, then there is muscularis propria, and then there is a serosal interface, which is again an echogenic line. So this is a typical bowel signature. This is a fluid within the stomach, and so you can get the better contrast there. And of course, when we are scanning the abdomen, we usually follow one pattern. You should scan the entire abdomen, so you should make these zigzag kind of a motion so that you're not missing out on any part, and then scanning the entire abdomen. And then with this, we come to the most common application, appendicitis. Normal appendix, rarely seen. In fact, sometimes in children, it is less than 6 millimeters. And whenever the appendix is inflamed, typically what we see is, this is the fat stranding which is seen around the inflamed appendix. And that is how we tend to diagnose the appendicitis in most of the cases. Of course, there is hypervascularity seen. So a normal appendix has less than 6 millimeter diameter. Anything which is more than 6 millimeter is usually surrounded by hyperechoic inflamed fat. And the other strongly supportive signs are presence of an appendiculate, cecal apical thickening, hypervascularity. As we saw in this particular patient, there was little hypervascularity, and on the color Doppler examination. So this is the appendiculate. You should see a blind ending pouch. And this is typically the, you know, periappendiceal fat stranding, which you see. So you have to identify the appendix, see that it is blind ending, non-compressible, or peristaltic tube. It has a gut signature arising from base of the cecum and diameter greater than 6 millimeters. And supportive features are, of course, inflamed perienteric fat, pericecal collections, and the appendicolates sometimes. Sometimes, you know, you can really diagnose the perforations by what? Loculated pericecal fluid or a phlegmon or abscess, prominent pericecal fat, and circumferential loss of the submucosal layer. If you can see in transverse, this layer is seen very well, but here there is a perforation. As you can see here, this is seen very well here, but then there is a perforation here. So this is how you will be able to diagnose. So you have to look at the blind ending surface, and then you will start seeing that it is perforated there. In fact, you can see this fluid, and there is a discontinuity of the mucosal lining there. So you can suspect the perforation. Then there is something called appendicular lump or a phlegmon. It is a large mass of non-compressible fat around the appendix, and usually managed conservatively because appendicectomy in such cases is technically difficult. But of course, there are exceptions to rules when sometimes in children, those patients with severe peritonitis, which tells you that walling off process is failing. Then even if it is, you know, formed a sort of a lump, these patients are operated because then otherwise they will go into septicemia. So this is how typically you see a kind of a lump. There is a fat, there are some bowel loops which are clumped inside, and there is of course the appendiceal inflammation which is seen. And you can see here that there is a lot of inflammation around, and probably this appendix has leaked or ruptured somewhere, and then these are the patients which have formed into an appendicular lump. So it is important to diagnose on ultrasound whether it is perforated, whether it has formed a lump, or it is just an acute appendicitis. And of course, then we'll come to these differential diagnoses which we, you know, see in the RIF pain. This patient again was suspected to be actually the appendicitis, but as you can see here, these are these linear kind of structures which are seen. This is typically a tapeworm infestation, and this is not actually the appendicitis which was there. The another differential, what needs to be considered in RIF pain is the diverticulitis. So right-sided colonic diverticulitis may clinically mimic appendicitis or cholecystitis. In contrast to sigmoid diverticuli, in fact, they are the more commoner ones, the right-sided colonic diverticuli are usually true diverticuli. That is, they have all the layers of the wall of the colon. And inflammatory changes in the pericolic fat with segmental thickening of the colonic wall at the level of inflamed diverticulum. That is what is the typical sign. This ascending colon that will be inflamed, there will be an outpouching seen, and there will be a fat standing which is seen around that. So that typically is the diverticulitis. It may be right-sided, left-sided, it will follow the similar pattern. So the ultrasound appearance will depend on the stage of the disease. In the earlier stage, focal wall thickening will be there. It will be hyperechoic, non-compressible tissue around that. That is the inflamed mesentery or the omentum. And it is trying to seal off the imminent perforation. That is the most important clue. So this is how the stage one will look. And once that abscess or that pus, you know, decompresses back into the colon, then the patient feels in fact better, and that is the stage of a resolution. So this is how typically you will see the patient complains specifically of a pain at one side, and when you use your high frequency transducer, you will see some kind of fat stranding and you will see some colon inside that. You know, it becomes a little difficult to, you know, put a lot of compression and try and see these structures better because they are in extreme pain. But you know, is here, if you can see somewhere, you see that there is an outpouching from the colon, and that probably is a diverticulum. Of course, we advise CT scan. This typically has formed that abscess. In fact, there is a small amount of air which is seen there. The diverticulitis can have the gut signs, which are segmental concentric thickening of the wall of that particular colon. I mean, it may be ascending colon, rectosigmoid, or a descending colon. The inflamed diverticuli will look like an echogenic foci within or beyond the gut wall. And there will be intramural sinus tract. Perinephric soft tissue, of course, will have all the signs of inflammation. That is inflammation of pericolonic fat, hyperechoic mass effect, thickening of the mesentery, or it may be abscess formation, which will be seen as a localized fluid collection, often with the gas component. So that is what clinches the diagnosis. And of course, it has formed a fistula. Then you will have the linear tracts from the gut to the bladder or to the vagina or to the skin or to the adjacent loops, and it may be hypo or hyperechoic depending on that. See, other differential what comes into the mind for the right iliac fossa pain will these, you know, inflammation of the epiploic appendages. These are also small fat containing structures, and these usually they can undergo torsion or it can have a secondary inflammation, and that causes focal abdominal pain in the right lower quadrant. So this is a self-limiting disease. This does not really need any operative kind of a management, and that's why it is very important to differentiate it from the appendicitis. The other differential which is there is about the omental infarction. Clinical presentation again is same, like appendicitis or epiploic appendicitis. A cake-like inflamed fatty mass, but which is larger than epiploic appendicitis. As you can imagine, the appendages are small structures, so they will have a small area of hyperechogenicity. But omental infarct can have a larger area, a cake-like inflamed fatty mass, and it may be difficult to distinguish it from the omental infarct to epiploic appendicitis. But this differentiation is not of clinical importance because the management remains the same. So at least you can give that. If it's a smaller kind of the inflamed fat without appendicitis seen, appendicular lumen seen inside, we say it may be epiploic appendicitis. If it is a large inflamed mass, then we call it as the omental infarction. Of course, CT is always better to confirm. So this was again another young patient where you can see that there is a large kind of an hyperechoic lesion, but you're not seeing any, you know, bowel signature in between. In fact, you can see these hypoechoic some strands inside, and there is a minimal perilesional fluid. This was the omental infarction. This is a large inflamed cake-like mass. So again, obesity is the risk factor. There is a fat accumulation in the appendages, or fat deposition may outgrow the blood supply, and then that's why it predisposes to ischemia. heavy exercise, excessive stretching, and that, you know, sometimes cause excessive movement of the omentum, and that can sometimes undergo torsion and can cause this problem. So omental infarction can be primary or secondary. Secondary, we all know, it sometimes is just post-surgery abdominal trauma or omental inflammation. The primary one, you know, occurs at around the right edge of the greater omentum because the arterial supply is very less in that area. And that's why it tends to happen on that side. There is arterial and venous compromise when it twists itself, and omentum may infarct without the torsion. And then this is called a primary idiopathic omental segmental infarction. So again, ultrasound features, as you know, little bit what you can differentiate between the two is, it is the right lower quadrant, secondary omental infarction at the site of initial insult, but usually they're larger than 5 cm, which helps to distinguish it from epiploic appendicitis. Ultrasound just shows you focal area of increased echogenicity in the omental fat, and the appendicitis have a smaller area of fat standing compared to the omental infarction. Ovoid central area of the preserved fat will be seen, and hyperdense central dot is the thrombosed vessel, and that will be seen on a CT scan, and there they are able to differentiate these better rather than ultrasound. Another non-specific entity, what we see in the mesentery, especially with the high-frequency ultrasound, is the mesenteric paniculitis. Chronic non-specific inflammatory process in the mesentery, and it may lead to fibrosis and retraction. So when there is fibrosis and retraction predominates, then we start calling it as fibrosing mesenteritis. When inflammation predominates, then we call it as mesenteric paniculitis. So these are just generally the thickened mesentery. What we see here as just a fat which is seen there. And these are sometimes, you know, just heterogeneous looking mesenteric kind of deposit of the fat. And as I said, sometimes the, you know, fibrosis predominates and retraction predominates, and then these will be called as retractile or paniculitis. And this is just the overall increased fat deposition there. You can see the, you know, bowel loops passing through it. And this may be just the cause of mesenteric paniculitis, and then we just suggest a CT scan. The another important thing is, of course, abdominal cocks. We all are good at detecting cocks. But the important findings of the abdominal cocks will be bowel involvement, especially the IC region, which gives us the pseudo-kidney, mucosa, submucosa complex thickening, small bowel strictures, though they are difficult to see. If you can, you know, see the focal dilatation of the bowel loop, and then you can trace that bowel loop, and sometimes that thickening of the wall will be seen better, so that small bowel strictures can be diagnosed. Peritoneal mesenteric thickening, the lymph nodes, of course, are better assessed by the high-frequency ultrasound, and ascites, these are the commoner findings. And as I said, the mesenteric deposits, the, you know, the peritoneal deposits, as you can see here, there will be, you know, some deposits on the peritoneal surface. These are lymph nodes also, but then there are these mesenteric deposits which are there. This again is the typical pseudo-kidney sign which we see in the Cox involvement. This is the bowel content, the lumen, and this is all the thickened kind of wall of the terminal ileum, and the cecum, which gives rise to that kind of an appearance. And this is a terminal ileum involvement. Again, as you can see here, thickening. And this was the IC cox again. So most of the times, we see the cervical lymph nodes getting diagnosed as cox, or there is pulmonary tuberculosis. These patients do come for abdominal screening. So careful assessment of the bowel, mesentery, lymph nodes, free fluid is a must. For follow-up, it is very important that you document these findings correctly, because they keep coming for a follow-up to see the response to the treatment. Abdominal wall lesions, of course, are important. Hernia, fat necrosis, lipomas, hematomas, the endometriosis. This we all know, it is just omental fat which has come out through the hernia. And this, in fact, patient feels as a lump and then comes for the ultrasound. So it is always important to scan with the high-frequency probe. Lipomas, sometimes if they're big, the patient can feel it. There may be just a fat necrosis which gives rise to pain in the abdomen, and that's why the patient comes for the ultrasound. And if you don't scan with the high frequency linear probe, you will miss these lesions. A suture granuloma sometimes, in fact, in postoperative patients, you know, just gives rise to these inflammations and these kind of pus formation there. And again, wound complications are important cause of this healing, and a lot of time patient is very worried. Whenever there is pain or lump kind of a feeling at the scar site, patient feels that something went wrong while doing the surgery, and then they keep coming for the ultrasound. Most of the times what we see are these hematomas, and these are just the seromas. As long as there is nothing intra-abdominal, these are not worrisome, and you just need to reassure the patient. This was a post-cholecystectomy patient. A laparoscopic cholecystectomy sometimes gives rise to these port hematomas, where the site of port, there is these properitoneal hematomas. They are not in the wall. They are separating just the peritoneum and the abdominal wall. And sometimes they have these properitoneal wall hematomas in which you need to diagnose. This is just the rectus hematoma. Patient continuously had the pain. Most of the times we see it when the patient is coughing all the time. And this is typically what we see in scar endometriosis. Those who are postoperative, they keep coming for these pain during menstrual cycle. It is very important to differentiate these between if they are only in the subcutaneous tissue or if they are also involving the rectus muscle, because the surgery changes. The chunk of a rectus needs to come out when it is intra-muscle, the endometriosis. So that needs to be always mentioned in your report whenever you are especially doing it for the scar endometriosis. It can appear as a solid or multi-separated cystic lesion. A very important site is to mention whether it is only in the subcutaneous, subcute with rectus extension, or exclusively within the rectus muscle. And that is very important to know. So no ultrasound abdominal examination is complete without high frequency scanning. Not just intra-abdominal, but abdominal wall scanning is important. And you respect patient symptoms. Even if you scan all the organs in the abdomen, if the patient says, I have a pain at particular site, where you know that there is no organ which is going to come there and cause any symptoms, you have to put your high frequency probe at that site and then look for anything positive there. So you should always respect the patient's symptoms and scan with high frequency probe. Thank you.